Definitely
Hello.
crazy.
Hello, everyone, and welcome to EMLC Love Series as we celebrate love during the month of February. My name is Crystal Johnson, and I'm the mental health clinician with the Family Life Commission. So we are in the year of the family still, and as we continue to highlight and celebrate, of course, all aspects of family, we wanted to continue the journey with you by sharing all these wonderful, enlightening, inspiring conversations with all types of family in our community about love. So our series will be based on the Amoris Letitia Joy of Love. Here's the book, right? From Pope Francis's Apostolic Exhortation on Love in the Family. I think every time I say this is a tongue twister, but it's a really, really awesome book. And our conversation today focuses on Amoris chapter 4, Love is Not Jealous and Not Boastful. Mm-hmm. So without further ado, I have the pleasure of introducing and chatting with our lovely couple today, Lauren and Brent Branca, ladies please, about their journey with this jealousy, this concept of jealousy and boastfulness. So thank you both for joining us this morning.
Nice, thanks for having us.
Thanks for having us. So since today is Valentine's Day, so we just wanted to tell everybody before we start, happy Valentine's Day. Yeah, go ahead.
Well, tell us a little bit about ourselves and then we kind of get into it.
Okay. You want to go ahead?
A little about myself. Well, what I say, where I work, who I am, what I do.
No, not really. I mean, Brent and I have been married for 4 years now.
It's not.
This year will be our fifth year.
Yeah.
Congrats. Yeah. Coming up.
Thanks. We've been together for 8 years, actually. So we kind of know each other for a relatively long time.
A long time, yeah.
Compared to some circumstances, you know. So yeah, we don't have any kids as yet, but we plan to have some in the future. Mm-hmm. And I think that's basically it about us, you know.
Yeah.
All right. Very nice. Short and sweet. But straight to the point. But nice 5 years, nice 8 years, and I think you guys knew each other from way back when too, right?
Yes, when you're 15 years old.
15 years old.
Yeah, yeah.
And I'm like, yeah.
I was actually his first kiss.
She was.
This is so cute for Valentine's Day today. Look how things kind of just, you know, God was just aligned from the get-go in a sense. You know, that's so cute.
Right.
So, definitely.
Mm-hmm. It's not that lovey-dovey conversation, but it is about jealousy and this boastfulness. So, you know, love is not jealous. And I don't think it simply has to do with being jealous because, you know, you saw Lauren speaking to this nice, tall, handsome gentleman at the supermarket. Or, you know, maybe friends stopping off at a little Starbucks and laughing with the barista. It's not just that. She's laughing. But jealousy is a form of sadness, really and truly, provoked by another's prosperity. It shows that we are not concerned for the happiness of others, but only with our own well-being. True love values the other person's achievement. It recognizes that everyone has different gifts and a unique path. So when I read that, I was like, oh, all right, there's a different angle to this that I totally forgot. So this concept of jealousy, is this something that you guys were familiar with before reading this? This the other side of it, I suppose. Not just the typical side like I described earlier.
Right. Yeah, I think the one described earlier is more of what you would usually fall to.
Conventional. Yeah.
Yeah, but the second concept there, where you have externals.
Mm-hmm.
I don't know. I'm kind of familiar with it, but I haven't really given it enough thought. I think in your daily lives to say, well, you know, this is something that really bothers me and analyze it in that regard. You know.
Mm. All right.
The original concepts, I am extremely aware of that, you know, that concept, I mean, that's all I saw jealousy as, you know, prior to our conversation, like that whole prosperity thing was so new to me. Mm-hmm. And then when I looked at it from that angle, mm-hmm. I was like, okay, well, I need to reevaluate my thoughts on jealousy because, you know, I am a jealous person. Mm-hmm. He knows that, you know, and I often wonder if he's a jealous person because I can't see that. But this new concept, maybe jealousy happens that way too.
It's so funny because I think, as you guys say, it's, I think it's more the conventional, traditional way where people think about jealousy. Like, so the same for me, I'm the jealous one, and I don't even think he has, my husband has a jealous bone in his body, to be quite honest. I don't even know. Just like you. You know, you might hear, well, you know, I spoke to a friend, I'm like, but I don't like her because of many reasons. I know about her. And you know, it's kind of funny, we can laugh at it, but that's the concept that I think I know I'm very familiar with, and just like you said. Mm-hmm. So if we're looking at the other angle now in regards to people's well-being and their own value and their own person, are there times where you guys are actually envious of each other's achievements? Let me just leave it at that.
Are you jealous of my achievements?
I wouldn't say so. I don't think I could say that I was ever like jealous of any of your achievements, anything that you were successful in. Mm-hmm. I can't say that.
And to be honest with you, like, I have to say, like, I'm very lucky to have Brent because he really is not jealous about my achievements. Like, that's one thing I think attracted me to him.
Right.
The fact that anything I succeeded in, he was there with me. Mm-hmm. You know, and he was just as happy in it with me, you know. So I could testify and say that I don't think he's jealous when it comes to the prosperity thing.
Yeah.
For me, it's different because it's not really like I'm jealous of the prosperity thing.
Yeah.
But I am jealous of the things that bring him accomplishments.
Right.
So I'm jealous of his, well, he has a particular hobby that he is very much, you know, involved in and stuff like that. Mm-hmm. And I mean, I love it for him, but I am jealous. And I love all the different things that it
exposes him to.
And I'm really proud of him when he gets like particular contracts and stuff like that.
Yeah.
But I get jealous when, you know, it takes him away from me.
Right.
And he doesn't see that, you know, he doesn't see that aspect of it.
Right. So,
yeah.
I like that version of it, your version of it, meaning that it's not about achievements but the time taken away in a sense. How about of just, you know, you guys talk about, you know, you get, you know, he's, I guess I'm, you're more calmer and Lauren is more vibrant, let's just say.
Yeah.
So how about like things like that as well, because I know for myself, like my husband is just such a cool, happy-go-lucky, nothing is falling, the world is just really fine kind of guy. And that irks me because, you know, and it gets to a point where, you know, I'm just so jealous that you could just keep it cool. You know, this is the person you are. And sometimes it just like frustrates me. And I'm just like, you know, gosh, I wish sometimes I could be like that in a sense. Do you guys have anything similar to that? Like, you know, personality-wise, the person who they are?
I think so.
What do you think? Tell me.
I think that you feel the same way that she does, which is like, I'll be like more relaxed or calm about a situation, but you'll be like worrying and thinking about it more.
Right.
Right. But I've heard Brent say numerous times that the way that I process things, mm-hmm. he wishes that he could process things that way too.
Right.
You know,
right.
And I've heard him because, like, you know, we do fight, you know, and we fight about things. And when we have to reason with each other out of the fight, you know, he always says to me, you know, you always tell me, you know, I don't, how do you process like things like that?
Like thinking about it from the other angle so quickly.
It's like, how are you able to process your emotions and explain it like that? You know, you often tell me that.
Yeah, that's true.
Yeah, so.
But does it frustrate either one when the other one doesn't get it? So, you know, sometimes, you know, it turns into, as you said, like the little fight. The little fight.
Yeah, you do get a little frustration. And yeah. I think it's, yeah. It seems like you see that balance of either who thinking about it so quickly or me relax about it, that you could just kind of sit and then after the whole argument and everything, that you could kind of, you know, only because it's been so many years that we together to realize, okay, I see where you're coming from and I understand where you're coming from to start to understand. You know.
Yeah.
But yeah, I think it was always a early frustration where, you know, I'm like, well, no, I want time to think about this, where she's like, I've already thought of five different angles on this thing, you know?
Yeah.
And how to express it, I should say.
Yeah. Very true.
Right. So is it like easily recognized when in that moment, and you know, she, you know, you both have different, very different thought processes. So is it easily recognized in the moment when you're trying to figure things out, that this is what's going on with myself and this is what's happening with me? So some introspection.
I wouldn't say so for myself. Right. As a parent. Mm-hmm. I think only more for you.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, it is for me because, you know, we all meet up very differently, and Brent and I come from different backgrounds.
Yeah.
But, you know, I've come to understand that the way we process things, it's just what it is. You know, I try not to push it anymore, and he tries to lean into my needs and I try to lean into his needs when it comes to things like that. But to bring it back to the point, I would like to say that I am a little jealous of how easy he is when it comes to... I am. I'm not gonna lie about it. Yeah. I am. I wish I could just chill out about it, but I just need to resolve it then and now. And I am jealous that he could just cool off.
But you and I need to woosah together. We would kind of just chill on his side, just calm together. And we'll be like, I'd have our bed session. But yeah, I hear you. So how are you guys able to get to that point of just acceptance then of that's who he is and that's how you are? Is it easily reached?
I don't think we're there yet.
We're not there yet, but we're on the way.
All
right, nice.
So we're on the way. But I could say that I definitely ain't there yet.
No problem.
I think like literally, as the old saying is, that experience is everything, and that you just have you have to allow. You can't always stop fights, or you can't always be happy. So it's a balance of allowing these little fights to go, but also taking a little bit away from each one.
Right. Yeah.
And that's why it's been so long. But because of all the little fights, small ones, big ones, along the way, that you start to realize certain things won't change. So how do I address it? It's not so much about changing what's wrong, but how to deal with it then.
Right.
How to circumnavigate that you'll know, okay, this person will always deal with it like this, will always say things like this.
Mm-hmm.
How do I make this, how do I progress in the argument instead of it just be raw?
Right.
Back. Yeah.
So I guess that's a journey, right? I suppose. And with the journey comes growth bit by bit. Yeah. So each fight, each recognition, each insight inwardly in regards to, you know, what I'm doing to you, whatever like that. It's a big learning curve, I think, as married couples, for sure. So, how you guys said, you know, you're not there yet, but you know you kind of get into that.
Kind of get there.
So I like that.
Yes, for sure, definitely.
All right, so.
And what's that statement?
Like, I'm going to do a high five just now. High five. I love it. All right, so we're moving on a little bit to now the love is not boastful, right? So Amora says, love inspires a sincere esteem for every human being and the recognition of his or her own right to happiness, right? Those who love not only refrain from speaking too much about themselves, but are focused on others. They do not need to be the center of attention. So when I read, and there's much more about the love is not boastful, but when I read that, it just reminded me of what I tend to see in families, or even experience myself in families, where our love becomes more of, I need to one up on you, basically. Mm-hmm. I need to prove something of my value, of my rights on you, rather than a love coming from, where's a love that's building you up instead. So is it, Have you guys experienced that kind of boastful love where, you know, someone's importance and knowledge becomes, I guess, a point of domination over you, whether with each other or within families?
I think for me, not from my end where I'm trying to throw it on someone, but I think from like on my family side growing up, I was exposed to that whole, you know, like, well, you know, I did this for you, or you know, I always thought about you this way, you know, they're expecting reciprocation.
Right.
You know, and that, I think, you know, you thinking about yourself, you don't always, how should I say, process how to reciprocate or what is equal value. And you have to know that what's important for the other person. It's not about it being equal in value, like showing each other like I love you in saying that you could love that person in your way, or they love you in their own way. And I think that's probably something that's always been a gray area then, or a cloudy area, I should say. It's of knowing, you know, what's enough for
two,
and if it will be accepted as adequate reciprocation of love.
Well,
with regard, from my perspective, you know, when we were talking about, we were going through the quotes and stuff like that, and then I got into, it was almost like a revelation, because the thing is, I will always be like, no, this is so cliche, so Ola, just bear with me. But I would always be like, I cook in, and I clean in, and I wash in, and this, and that, and I count in all the tasks. I don't have enough fingers for the amount of things I'm doing. I have to start using my toes, right? And I use that as boastful love. Right. You know, like, doing all these things, and you ain't doing nothing, you know, right? Doing nothing, right? So, and it's so bad. Like, I remember, like, now it has gotten so much better, but like, I would use that in an argument with him, or I would be doing something and he would say something and that would just trigger my boastful love. You know, like, I love you so much, look at all these things you're doing, and you know, you, there's nothing you could do that could compare to all the things that I'm doing. And then honestly, like, friends would be like, well, he, as I said, he's very calm and cool and chill. So he'd be like, okay, well, I will try to do X better and I'll try to do this. But when I looked at it in retrospect, I was like, this is not working. Because I'm always trying to be one up on you. And we don't need that in this marriage. You know? That's how it is.
It's funny because I think as I listen to you and I reflect on me, you sound very, we sound very familiar, because I'm always like, one, two, three, four, what did you do today? I know the person, my husband is not doing something, but it just feels like if, you know, you're multitasking so many things at the same time, and, you know, you're literally going one, two, three, one, two, three, kind of thing. And they're just walking in like graceful swans, just on the lake kind of thing. But, you know, it feels like, I think it's so borders when we're in that type of mental state, it borders really on arrogance. And it's trying to recognize, sometimes even with them myself too, when I'm being like that, even towards my husband. Do you think, so, I mean, I know you recognize it with yourself and you're kind of putting your foot down and say, well, this is not working for us. But how do you handle it on both sides? You know, when you're letting it out and you're receiving it, Brent, how do you guys handle it in the moment to kind of get you guys back to that space of, you know, groundedness, humility, you know, back to the united front type of situation?
Well, I think that always depends on your temperament at the time. Because, I mean, I can easily say, I vacuumed yesterday. I washed the wares yesterday.
No, wait, be honest.
Your argument is like, you know, your argument is a little flaky, right?
No, but the funny thing, when we start a fight about things like that, Brent's way of dealing with fights is doing chores. So my boy, all of a sudden, find the vacuum, find the broom. The bathroom need cleaning all the time, you know, and he makes himself so busy when I talk about how I am busy.
But the beautiful part about that is that you didn't have to ask to do those things. So we just ask. No, seriously, though, that's like a defense mechanism. For me, I just get busy.
Yes.
Right. So instead of like fighting back and making.
You're going to do some actions then.
I just start, I go into this mode and I just start doing everything.
You just start doing things.
And then she's like, aren't you not going to talk about what we're talking about? But, you know, I'm just like, so
he basically, when we're fighting about those things, I can't say, Crystal, that we have a remedy or something that because to be honest, each fight we have about boastful love in particular, that fight about I am doing more than you.
Yeah.
I don't know. Every time we fight about that fight, it feels like brand new. It feels like we never fight about our fights and they have no outside.
Yeah.
You know, there's no way of fixing it.
But you know, the funny thing is, but I like to say that. But, you know, when you say I am doing more than you, it basically translates to I am more than you. And that's when it becomes boastful, right? So even, and as you said, I recognize too, even within my marriage too, there's not a really set remedy. It's kind of like every time something happens, you're just trying to figure it out bit by bit and learning from it. But I definitely think, you know, it's a lot of sit and pause type of thing to realize when I am getting flustered and I don't want to feel like that anymore. That's when it kind of kicks in with what am I trying to achieve? What am I doing? Kind of thing. So I don't know if you have some moments sometimes that splits up like, okay, I'm all flustered, I'm all angry, I'm all this, I'm this, but this is not how I want to feel, and this is not how I want to act. So then that's when the introspection comes. So have those moments. That pops in ever so often.
I think she definitely has those moments, but like I said, even in my defensive action by trying to remove myself from the situation, if it's getting myself busy or cleaning, whatever it is.
Yeah, yeah.
That's my version of kind of cool your brain.
Yeah.
Because you can easily just mindlessly answer.
Yeah.
For answering sake. Mm-hmm. And not that it's a constructive answer then, you know?
Yeah.
I hear you guys. So last question. Yeah. Well, go ahead. Finish up. Yeah.
Two definitely is I think to be more retrospective.
Right.
When she goes into after, or I guess like say the argument is
happening.
Right.
And then she has to sit for a second if she goes inside and think about it.
Yeah.
Your mind keep doing things before your steam starts to fly. Like,
I like sound effects, friends. So we're going to the last one. So how do you guys let each other be then and continue to, I think you mentioned it a little bit by bit throughout that last conversation, but how do you continue to persevere in the love marked by the humility and understanding and forgiveness?
How do we continue to persevere through it all? Brent and I spend a lot of time. We try to make time for each other.
Yeah.
We really do. Like the weekends are ours, and we spend a lot of time together. You know, it's only been now different for us with his hobby and stuff like that. You know, you would hardly see us out without each other.
Right.
So that's how we persevere, I think, in love, because we really love being around each other.
Right.
And we also talk about a lot of things. We try to cook together. You know, that's something that we do together. Brent drives me anywhere I want to go.
Right.
You know, and we spend a lot of time together in each other's space. And I think that is what helps us to persevere in love and in humility and, you know, finding that joy within each other. We really do love spending time with one another.
And I think it's about supporting each other too. So like she said, you know, if she's doing all the cooking, I'm going to either help with some vegetables or washing the
waves.
Or like say, you know, we have to go out somewhere. She's like, okay, cool. You know, I'm going to come with you. I'll help you do this. So yeah, in that regard, you know, you're caring for the other person. You're showing them that you love them by assistant. Yeah. It doesn't matter if you, it's something that you think you would have been interested or not. Mm-hmm. They're just trying to be there.
Yeah. Trying to support him. As jealous as I may be about that hobby mm-hmm. and the time it takes mm-hmm. from me, because I am with Brent, you know, Brent is my everything. So, you know, after God, he is the man that has been created for me, you know, I am a jealous person. So anything, it could be a person or it could be a thing, anything that takes him away from me, I feel jealous. Yeah. But as I said, in order to stay together and stay close, we spend a lot of time together. We really do spend a lot of time together.
Yeah, and I think that's nice because, you know, in the midst of everything and sometimes the chaos, even not just with the externals, but even within, your first go-to is to come together, mm-hmm. right? It's not to go apart. It's not to do things. I mean, you guys respect each other's individuality, but definitely it's to come back to each other. And mm-hmm. many things are being served and not spending time together. It's, you know, it's as I said, is the forgiveness, the understanding, the humility, the quality time, just connecting, even sometimes connecting in that way, even without saying anything, you know, it just, you know, that time together, doing each other's things, doing things together. I think that's so nice to hear. And I think if even in the midst of everything in all relationships in marriage or families, I think that's why we continue to say, you know, we should do things together in family all the time, spend time. I think that's something key in this whole year of family is just drive to come together, because in togetherness, we could really face anything, I believe.
Anything.
So this was such a lovely conversation with you guys. I thank you both for sharing your journey with us today. Oh my God, I hope everyone enjoyed our segment today, and we at the Airbusy continue to pray that all families continue to experience the joy of love. Happy Valentine's Day from the AFLC, the Family Life Commission, and of course the Broncos here with us. So you guys stay safe. Goodbye and enjoy your Valentine's Day.
Valentine's Day.
Bye, everyone.
Thanks for having us.